Hello, and thank you for watching this Sloan C. presentation on Technology for Teaching and Learning. Technology for teaching and learning is quite a large topic, and it is often difficult for faculty to know where to begin. So to help you get started, I'll be discussing the things you should consider as you decide when and how to use technology in your courses. For those of you teaching blended or online courses, using technology is a given. Even so, it is a good idea to ask yourself, why use technology? Initially, many institutions turn to technology to improve access and decrease efficiency. Their aim is to make their courses as widely available to as many students as possible, and to do so in an efficient way. The result, of course, is blended and online learning. However, every individual teacher can also take advantage of the benefits of technology for each of their courses. Faculty can use technology to improve access, increase efficiency, enhance presence, deepen engagement and satisfaction, and improve learning outcomes when they learn to use technology effectively. And we're not just talking about the benefits for your students. You too can experience the benefits of access, efficiency, presence, engagement, and satisfaction in every course you teach. One of the first things you should consider is how the technology is going to impact your overall course design. When faculty first begin to experiment with technology for teaching and learning, they often start at the enhancement level and then move toward the transformation level as they become more comfortable and experienced with technology. The important thing to consider here is that there are different ways technology can be used in your course. You might use technology as a substitute or use it to augment what you're doing. Or you may choose to modify or redefine your course to take full advantage of things you can do with technology that you couldn't do without that technology. In your course, will you be using technology as an enhancement, or will you be striving to truly transform the learning environment? Yet another thing to consider is when to use asynchronous technology and when to use synchronous technology. Synchronous and asynchronous technologies each have unique benefits and challenges. There are things that are definitely best accomplished via synchronous work, while other things benefit more from asynchronous work. Synchronous work is more suited for personal participation. It can help increase interest and motivation, and it is also great for coming to consensus. Asynchronous work, on the other hand, lends itself better to cognitive participation because it allows time to focus and reflect on the learning. The optimal environment would include opportunities for both asynchronous and synchronous work in order to improve access, efficiency, social and cognitive presence, engagement and satisfaction, and, of course, learning outcomes. Another consideration is finding technology. Many of you may be thinking, I don't need to look for technology, it finds me. For those of you teaching online and blended courses, that is most certainly the case, since you're undoubtedly using a learning management system, or LMS, as part of your teaching strategy. The LMS has a number of features that provide opportunities for using technology for teaching and learning. For example, they have discussion forum tools, assignment Dropbox tools, and quiz tools. And most LMSs offer wiki and blog options, as well as audio and video streaming capabilities. So, the LMS is a great tool set to begin your technology journey. Of course, there are other technology options as well. Technology in the Web 2.0 category offers you and your students even more ways to interact with each other and with the content. And of course, there are all those other tools, the ones that don't fit neatly into the Web 2.0 category or are not part of your LMS, but that could be extremely beneficial for you and your students. So, when you have time, I encourage you to not only delve more deeply into the possibilities provided by your LMS, but to also scan the list of tools at the Center for Learning and Performance Technologies and to review the EDUCAUSE library for tips and strategies for using those tools effectively. Finding tools isn't the hardest part, though. Figuring out how you're going to use them is a huge consideration, as is evaluating the tools to see if they'll add to the value of your course. So, let's take a quick look at a three-step evaluation process for any technology you're considering using for teaching and learning. We'll be looking at each of these steps in more detail. For now, just consider that you should evaluate any tech use based on how well it supports your learning objectives, how user-friendly the tool is, and how well it supports the criteria for quality online education is noted by several different research-based criteria lists, including the concepts of interactions, the 7 principles, the quality matters rubric, and the 5 pillars. The number one criteria for the use of any tool is whether the tool will help your students achieve the stated learning objectives. While it is tempting to select tools because they are fun or new, those criteria alone will not necessarily help your students learn what they need to learn in order to be successful in your course. So, before you choose a tool, write out your learning objectives and have an idea how students can demonstrate they've achieved those objectives. Then, evaluate the tool on that basis. If the tool can't support the objectives, there is no point in you spending any more time evaluating it further. Your next step is to determine how user-friendly the tool is. In this case, I'm using the phrase user-friendly to include not only how easy the tool is to use, but also how well it supports your goals for privacy and copyright, not to mention how easy it will be for you to use for teaching. Evaluating tools with these criteria in mind will save you time by narrowing your tool choices to a few that you will evaluate further. There is no sense in spending time evaluating a tool for its educational benefits if it doesn't pass the user-friendly criteria. While I originally named this eval tool the Web 2.0 Selection Criteria Checklist, it can be applied to any technology. I'll cover some of the highlights. Under the criteria of access, what you are most interested in is, can everyone use this technology, regardless of their computing device or any disabilities they may have? You want to avoid choosing tools, for example, that are for Windows users only. For the criteria of usability, you're evaluating how easy the tool is to use. Tools that are difficult to learn or that don't provide support materials may be more trouble than they're worth. Privacy and intellectual property are two criteria that are often overlooked but very important. The ability to restrict access to student work, like you can in an LMS, is not always a huge concern, but you should have the option if you choose. Additionally, you don't want to require students to use tools from companies that will share their contact info or put some sort of claim on their or your copyright for the materials you create using the tool. Of course, workload and time management is another important criteria. Aside from the initial extra work involved with learning the tool, you really want to avoid using tools that are going to cause you a lot of extra work. Finally, there's nothing wrong with experiencing a little fun in the learning environment. It shouldn't be your only criteria, but it certainly should not be undervalued either. Now that we've covered the first two evaluation steps, it is time to look at step three, which is evaluating tools for how they can help you address educational quality criteria. By this time, you've probably narrowed your technology choices for a particular activity or set of activities to just a few. That will save you time as you begin a more extensive eval of the tool for its contribution to the overall quality of your course. There are certainly plenty of published criteria for what makes a quality online learning experience. We'll discuss four of those. The first is the Sloan C. Quality Framework, also known as the Five Pillars. Quality metrics in this framework include learning effectiveness, faculty and student satisfaction, scale, and access. Another quality metric is the Quality Matters Rubric. While the rubric has criteria for every aspect of your course design, it is one section devoted to technology use. The criteria in that category state that the technology should be current and easily accessed, and that it should support learning objectives, engagement, and active learning. The criteria of interactions, which is the foundation for much of the research on quality online learning, states that good teaching encourages student-to-teacher, student-to-student, and student-to-content interactions. Tools that support these interactions would contribute to the quality of your online course. Finally, the Seven Principles criteria covers student-to-faculty contact, prompt feedback, active learning, cooperation, time on task, high expectations, and diverse ways of learning. As you may have noticed, there's quite a bit of overlap among the various criteria. You could use one or all of these to help you determine if a tool you're thinking about using will add value to your course. In summary, when it comes to using technology for teaching and learning, remember that technology can help improve access, increase efficiency, enhance presence, deepen engagement and satisfaction, and improve learning outcomes when it is used effectively. As you look for tools, consider whether you will be using technology to enhance or transform the learning experience. Determine when you'll be using synchronous and asynchronous tools, and evaluate potential tools by how well they support learning objectives, how user-friendly they are, and how well they'll enhance the quality of the learning experience. Thank you. I hope you found this presentation helpful. May your use of technology for teaching and learning be successful, enjoyable, and educational.